الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Continue إن شاء الله تعالى with الرسالة التبوكية and the some of the benefits. We're not going word by word with the رسالة, but just some of the benefits that are very important for someone that wants to take that journey, the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be steadfast upon the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This life, everything in it is moving, and we are moving. And there's oftentimes you would find in the Nusus the subject of as-safar, or traveling, or taking the path of Allah, salat al-mustaqim. So everything is moving, and there's a destination, there's an end of all things. وَأَنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَى. Indeed, with your Lord is the end. The end of all things is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the end, meaning in the hereafter, whether in Jannah or wal'iyadhu billah, in the hellfire. And this is the everlasting life. So as a result of that, to be steadfast on the salat al-mustaqim, a person need the help of matters of knowledge to know how to be steadfast, and then the actions that are required. And it's by the mercy of Allah that this is not left to our own interpretations and opinions and likings, but rather this is all from Allah, all wahi from Allah, nothing but revelation from Allah. So that's how the matter is very clear, no ambiguity, no confusion in it whatsoever. The principle that we talked before this treasure about how to establish the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the rights of the human beings, which is what this entire life is all about, and what's the entire religion of Islam is about this. So to be with al-haq, with the truth, bila khalq, without witnessing with your heart the creation of Allah. That means your ultimate goal is to submit yourself to the commands of Allah, and not to allow the human beings to distract this ultimate goal in one's life. So to be obedient to Allah. Basically, the obedience of Allah comes before anything. لا طاعة لمخلوق في معصية الخالق. No obedience to any مخلوق, any creation of Allah, in the disobedience of Allah. And the, when it comes to dealing with the خلق, أن تكون مع الخلق بلا نفس. When you're dealing with people, your nafs, your own self, is not part of it. You're not looking at yourself. Basically means the arrogance, the egos, the things that prevents the person from fulfilling the rights of others. But rather to see exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us when we deal with one another, and we put that forward before our own likings and desires and so on. And this is all part of the deen. This is, has been mentioned before. That leads to basically the core of the message of the book, which is the subject of al-hijrah lillahi wa lirasulihi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The hijrah to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We know that al-hijrah is mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And this hijrah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even praised the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, that are of two categories, al-muhajirin and the ansar. Al-muhajirin, what is muhajirin? They're not necessarily the people of Mecca. Usually you say the people of Mecca, the Sahaba from Mecca. No. Those who migrated with the Prophet ﷺ, those who made hijrah as a religious obligation, not just because they moved, as a religious obligation, as a command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they migrated from, they made hijrah from Mecca to Al-Madin. And Al-Ansar, they are the people of Al-Madina, those who welcomed them, those who helped them. And that's the word Al-Ansar. And that's why the word Al-Nasr, when it's oftentimes translated as victory, is not really victory. Al-Nasr is what help means. So in Tansurullah Yansurkum, Allah will help you with whatever means of help that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decree for you. If you make the words and the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala established and superior in your life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you. Sometimes the help is physical help. Sometimes it's for you to be steadfast upon the deen of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will for the physical help to come later. It doesn't mean that you're defeated. The real defeatism is when the person is defeated within his own self, when he turned away from للصراط المستقيم. He's the defeated one. But as long as a person is firm upon what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from him, that means he's being helped by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means he is victorious in that sense. And that is the foundation for the physical one that people like. But this is not the ultimate goal of the believers. The ultimate goal of the believers is to establish the ubudiyyah to Allah, to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all times. When the subject or the concept of al-hijrah is not talking about the physical hijrah. And as he mentioned that al-hijrah, hijratan, there are two types of hijrah. The physical one, bil-jism, with one's body from one place to the other. And there's ahkam to this, there's rulings to this, well known, established in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is not what is meant by what he's talking about here. So this, not everybody would be able to do this act of obedience to Allah. The Ansar, the people of Al-Madina, Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they did not make the physical hijrah because they are from the people of Al-Madina. So were they deficient? Of course, in general, the Muhajireen of a higher virtue than the Ansar in general, not in every single person of them. Why? Because of the level of the hijrah. Because the hijrah requires sacrifice. They sacrificed. They were the foremost. They are the ones that witnessed torture and all kinds of sacrifices for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then they migrated, left their wealth and their families and everything for the sake of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded them. They did not even do it because it makes sense that way. It was a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they moved as a result of that. This one has its rulings. And people should ask the people of knowledge. But what is meant by, in this subject here, the non-physical hijrah, which is fard, an obligation upon every single Muslim. So the hijrah is a religious duty. It doesn't matter whether you are living in Mecca, looking at the haram 24 hours a day, or you are in the furthest place away from Mecca. You have to make hijrah to Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is something that has to stay. It's a state, right? So when a person made hijrah, that means he moved. And that's why he says, al-hijrah means what? Min ila. There's two parts of it. From to. You make hijrah from one place to another place. So the obligatory hijrah is also from to. And the evidence of that is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ when he said, al-muhajir man hajara ma naha Allahu an. Al-Muhajir, and he defined him with Al-Alif Wal-Lam. The Muhajir, the immigrant. The word, when you say immigrant, means what? The physical hijrah, right? So Al-Muhajir, the real Muhajir, the real one that makes the hijrah, is the one man hajara, that's the verb of Al-Hijrah. Man hajara, the one that migrated away from what Allah forbade. So this is an obligation upon every Muslim, to stay away from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade. But he did not use any word except hijrah and al-muhajir. Because the physical hijrah has an effect on understanding the meaning. And always the non-physical meanings, how do we perfect it? By relating it to the physical aspects of things. Because we understand physical things very clearly. That's why there's so many amthal and parables are explained in the Quran. Physical matters. For you to be able to touch it. Something tangible. Something that no one can have doubts about it. Then the same concept is in the non-physical aspects of things. So when someone made hijrah, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they made hijrah physically. So when they made hijrah, they're not there anymore. They're not in Mecca anymore. They are in Medina. It's not one leg in Mecca and one leg in Medina. Physically, they are completely moved from Mecca to Al-Medina. They left everything. If they had homes and so, they left it. For the sake of Allah, if they can carry something with them that they own, they would do that. But if it's something that is bigger for them, they cannot take it because they have to move. So they left their valuables, one of the most important things, the place where they were raised and attached to, and everybody has their attachment to the place that they born and raised in, and their families, their wealth, their tijara, well establishment, plus more than anything else, it's the best spot on the face of earth to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Makkah. When someone leaves the best spot on the face of earth, maybe if it's something else, a person would not care. So when they made that hijrah, it's completely removing oneself. This is exactly how it's supposed to be when a person leaves what Allah forbade. not going back and forth. And even the Prophet والسلام, when he was sad because of what happened to Sa'd ibn Khawla radiallahu anhu, because they went to Mecca for Hajj. The Prophet والسلام, when he went to Hajj in Mecca, and Mecca is the best place on the face of earth, and now Mecca is land of Islam. لا هجرة بعد الفتح. As the Prophet والسلام, he said, no hijra after the fatḥ of Mecca, after the opening of Mecca, that's it. There's no hijra from it anymore. And the Prophet والسلام, returned to Mecca, and the people of Al-Ansar now, they thought the Prophet والسلام, is going to leave in Medina. Now he's back to Mecca. Mecca definitely is better in general than Al-Medina. And the Salah in Mecca, in the Masjid al-Haram, 100,000 times. In Medina, 1,000. So there's no comparison. Mecca is more virtue. But with that, the Prophet والسلام, when he went for Hajj, he only stayed in Mecca not more than 4 days. So that he does not break his hijrah. So that he still continuously called muhajir, because this is a religious duty. He made hijrah from it, so he's not going to go back to it anymore. Because he left it for the sake of Allah, even though it's a land of Islam. So that he would keep the concept of al-hijrah. And the hadith and the virtue of it are so many. So this is how the, when the Prophet ﷺ, when we understand this, al-muhajir man hajara manaha Allahu an. Al-muhajir is the one that made hijrah from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade. And when the Prophet ﷺ was in Mecca, Sa'd ibn Khawla was from the muhajirin. And he was with the Prophet ﷺ. He was sick in Mecca. And he died in Mecca. And the Prophet ﷺ was sad that he did not die in Medina. He did not die in the place that he made hijrah to, even though this is the qadr of Allah. And he died in the best spot ever. But he felt bad for him because he did not die in the place that he made hijrah to. And as mentioned in some of the nusus, that when a person dies after the hijrah, that the earth will be measured and the reward will be given of how far he is from the place that he migrated from. So, but the... This is how the concept of al-hijrah when it comes to the non-physical matters. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from the believers when they leave what Allah forbade. A person had his own lifestyle, sins, friends that would take him and would do things that is not permissible, you know, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he made tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the hijrah from this. Yes, you can give da'wah, you can have good relationships. That doesn't mean that you're not making hijrah, but in the heart, that's it. A person had, you know, what's the words? Removed himself, uprooted himself to be in a different state. So this is basically what the concept, and we will talk about it in many different ways so that we don't take too much time. But I just wanted to quote some of the things in the beginning, and then we'll stop, inshallah ta'ala. So he talks about when someone, that's it, he's now is about to embark on that journey. And he's going to the place that he's going to, and that requires for the person to leave his acquaintance, the things that he's used to. When you're at home, and this is one of the meanings also for i'tikaf and Ramadan and things like this, you have your norms. You wake up at a certain time, you have something that you drink, rituals that we make for ourselves, even rituals when a person goes to the bathroom, right? When people take a shower, there's rituals. Right, they have to take this first, and then that, and this first, and then this soap, and this shampoo, and this conditioner, and this, all kinds of things. Right, but when you're traveling, when you're not in your norm, this is what is actually what is meant by these types of things, so that a person does not get attached to his norms. And your norm is to sleep every day a certain hours. In the last 10 nights of Ramadan, you don't sleep much or you don't sleep at all. It's okay. It's okay to disturb the norms for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but not to spend the whole night playing because it's the night of Ramadan. So the issue of al-ma'lufat, the issue of the things that a person gets used to, and al-awa'id. And that's why, as Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentioned other part, that the weakest level of al-iman, the weakest level of al-iman, iman al-awa'id, the iman of the habits, or the iman of based on one's culture, based on one's norm, has been used to do these types of acts of ibadah. Which is good, mashallah, this is his norm. But this is the weakest level of al-iman because it's a norm, not because of some zeal that he has every time in his heart and the sincerity and making sure that it's done with devotion and things like this. So and leaving the things that he gets used to with his watan, the watan, the one's place of birth and living his country and things like this, then it would make the person then think of what he's going, and then what he's going to spend the rest of his life doing that, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with. So this is what is meant to make that level or type of hijrah to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it's much broader than just to make hijrah from the sins to the obedience of Allah. No, you with one's heart, a person making hijrah to Allah. Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he said to his people, he said what? Surah Al-Ankabut, قَالَ إِنِّي مُهَاجِرٌ إِلَى رَبِّي. I'm migrating to my Lord, leaving everything to my Lord, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this hijrah to Allah, what does it mean? Which is an obligation. Even if you're still staying in the place that you were born and raised in, you still have to make hijrah to Allah with your heart and with your actions. And you have to make hijrah to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is fard upon every Muslim, even if you did not physically move. This is basically what he's going to mention, how to make hijrah to Allah, how to make hijrah to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, فَإِنَّهَا فَرْضُ عَيْنٍ عَلَى كُلِّ أَحَدٍ فِي كُلِّ وَقْتٍ. It's فرض عين. That means it's an obligation upon every person at all times. وَأَنَّهُ لَنْ فِكَاكَ لِأَحَدٍ عَنْ وَجُوبِهَا. And no one can ever be detached from this obligation. It's an obligation upon everyone and no exceptions. No one to say, but women, it's okay. Children, of course, children are not مُكَلَّفِين. But my situation, that other person's situation, no, everybody. It's an obligation upon everyone to make the hijrah to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he says, وَهُوَ مَطْلُوبُ اللَّهِ وَمُرَادُهُ مِنَ الْعِبَادِ. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from His ibad. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from the believers to make that hijrah. So there is the physical one and the non-physical one, which is the subject of that, which is الْهِجْرَةُ بِالْقَلْبِ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. To make hijrah with one's heart to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وهذه هي المقصودة هنا. هنا. This is what is the objective here. This is what is meant here. وهذه الهجرة هي الهجرة الحقيقية. This is the real هجرة. وهي الأصل and it's the foundation. وهجرة الجسد, the physical هجرة تابعة, follows. The صحابة رضي الله عنهم, they did not make the physical هجرة and then the one with the heart followed. No, it was in the heart first. And then the second one, according to the ruling, can follow. So this is the hijrah that he's going to be mentioning, inshallah ta'ala, the hijrah with one's heart to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make His benefit and to make us among those who are firm upon the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll continue inshallah ta'ala tomorrow if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka Muhammad wa sahbihi wa sallam.